afternoon, everybody. Thanks for coming back from lunch. I'm really excited to be here, and I'm so excited that this forum and symposium are here in the state of Missouri so that I could attend and hear what everybody has to say, because it's been very interesting. In my position at the SHPO office, most of my work revolves around determining if a building is eligible for the National Register. If it is, what effects that will have on the property. After you determine if a property, or during determining if a property is eligible, you have to kind of classify it, know what it is, know how to talk about it, understand the context. So I'm sure you know, you guys, like me, have looked at some of the elegant freeform shapes created during the mid-20th century and thought, that's lovely, graceful, and architecturally significant. But I'd hate to be the person who has to talk about it in a National Register nomination. I know many people have been nominating buildings, mid-20th century concrete buildings, to the National Register and have found ways to describe them. But many of us as preservationists may just be starting to understand the history of freeform concrete shell buildings and how, little did we know that this breakdown in architectural, mathematical, and engineering information and understanding has more to do with who designed the buildings rather than how they were constructed. Freeform is defined as an object that does not conform to a regular or traditional shape. Early practitioners working in freeform concrete would often use a mix of masonry and concrete. Two preeminent practitioners were Antoni Gaudí and Rudolf Steiner. One of the things that Antoni Gaudí did that was very important was he designed his buildings using funicular models. And so what that is he'd hang chains and sheets of fabric from the ceiling. He designed the buildings upside down, and then he'd flip them right side up to using the tension shapes and creating the compression systems. So that's what was particularly interesting about his properties. And then Steiner, he was really designing in Switzerland, and the example on the left is a good example of kind of the early form follows function. This is a boiler, and the smokestack has the projecting smoke and fire, and then the base has the two round boilers. In the early 30s, the first thin shell monolithic building was constructed in Algeciras, Spain, and the freeform modern movement took off. These types of construction were popular as they were structurally efficient, carry loads perpendicular to their surface, and can, in moments, bend to create and sustain equilibrium. They're also able to span a large space in an artistically pleasing manner. So how is it made? The original, most predominant, and time-tested practice involves making a wooden frame and then installing rebar over it, and finally you pour concrete onto the rebar. This was a very effective method, but not very an economical method. So while labor and materials were inexpensive, this was a popular type of construction. In the mid-20th century, advances in concrete technology happened, especially with shotcrete and sprayed concrete technology, and they started creating the buildings without the wood form, but they would still have to pay skilled craftsmen to create these rebar and mesh forms. So here's some of the examples of the rebar and mesh going up, and then this is just more examples of the school structure being built, and you can see in the lower left the going up of the rebar, and then in the right as they were starting to spray the concrete on, and then the final finished product. Another type of construction became popular in the post-World War II period when the housing shortage led California architect Wallace Neff to create a new construction technique which implemented pneumatics and shotcrete to create a bubble house. While his efforts were not popular, his work inspired the Bruni shells and Airform monolithic domes, which are still in production today. Airform buildings are created by first laying a concrete foundation and then attaching and inflating a dome-shaped balloon, spraying the interior with polyurethane foam. Next, pre-shaped rebar hoops are installed, and finally, shotcrete is sprayed onto the rebar. Another technique which became popular, and it's very popular in more recent free forms, which are called digital forms, and this because of the use of AutoCAD and, you know, different digital technologies. This form is, they create like a polystyrene form, they install rebar and concrete, and then they pop the forms out to create buildings like this one. I had no clue this was concrete at first. But overall, not much has changed. New methods of technology have come along, but most of the time-tested, most beloved construction technique for this is still the wooden formwork. In recent years, there has been a resurgence in interest in concrete preforms and thin shell concrete. These are called the digital forms, as I said. The renewed interest has led to new experiments in different types of forming technology, including fabric formwork, pre-milled formwork, and vacuumatic formwork. So far, I'm sure this all seems pretty straightforward, and it doesn't explain why we have a lack of information regarding these building forms. Traditionally, as a style nears the 50-year mark, we preservationists start looking into the primary architects who designed in the style, researching the history, and establish a lingua franca. But in the case of freeform thin shell concrete, there's a change. Architects step aside and engineers take the forefront. It's not only this transition to engineers from architect, but the heavy influence of math used to create these artistic properties. But there's a language barrier. Many of these buildings became popular in the post-World War II period as aesthetically pleasing alternatives for reconstruction in Europe. So a lot of the articles that you find from the period, and even today, written about the topic, are written in German or Dutch or Italian, and I had to use Google Translate because I'm an American, and I'm bad about it. Okay, so if you've tried to research the topic, you may run across cases like this. You're reading a translated article from English into English from German or Dutch, and you run across diagrams like this, where the article has been translated into English, but the diagrams, the real meat, haven't been translated. Or once you get past that, you run into lovely quotes like, curvature of a curved space is the product of two principles, kg equals k1 times k2. Or negative Gaussian curvature characterize an anti-classic surface. That's all great, but it's a lot of math, and these two quotes are actually from the easiest to understand and interpret article that I found on vacuumatic formwork. So what did all of this come down to? So I researched all of these things, and then I've got all these mathematical principles, and I've got all these formulas. But what this really boils down to is there are three to four types of forms. You have Gaussian, analytical, experimental, and now in the current period, digital forms. So what do those theories, principles, and how do they translate into the built environment is my next question. So what exactly is Gaussian curvature? Oh, we don't want to look at that. Anyway, no. So in a layman's terms, Gaussian curvature is formed by deforming portions of a flat plane into different shapes. Shapes include sphere, dome, hyperbolic paraboloid, groined vaulted hyperbolic parabola. Okay, I know what these shapes are called. What are they? What does that mean, deforming a flat plane? So the first type that the most easiest for us to understand is the dome. And so if we think of this piece of paper as our flat plane, you will form the dome by, you know, pushing on the flat plane here, and you create the dome. Oh, okay, so that works. So here we've got two examples, the concave and the convex version. The one in the top right is just a local office building in West Plains, Missouri, and the other is the Grider House in Ocean Springs, Mississippi. All right, so what's a hyperbolic paraboloid? That's a really big couple of words. So what that means is if you take your flat plane and you deflect it like this, because what we're doing is we're applying pressure to two corners in opposite direction of the applying pressure to the other two corners to create this shape. It's kind of like a saddle, and sometimes you can even add a bend to the middle to give it the shape. So here's some examples of the hyperbolic paraboloid, the local example being the Union Memorial United Methodist Church here in St. Louis, and that's on the right. Okay, so now what's the groin vaulted hyperbolic paraboloid? Well, it's kind of, you know, complicated, and we've seen this one, and how does that translate into what we know about our piece of paper? So what this is basically is a crumpled piece of paper. It's the most visually complicated and one of the more complicated to construct and make. But what it is it's a series of the hyperbolic paraboloids joined together by a circle. It's kind of like a wave around a centerpiece. Okay, so that's Gaussian forms. The second group of forms, analytical forms, are shapes derived from closed mathematical formulas and can be calculated and perfected by mathematical processes. They became popular free forms due to advances in computing and the desire of architects to use artistic forms. These forms began to appear in the built environment in the 1930s, and their popularity continued until the 1960s, when it became too expensive to construct many of them. Analytical forms are those based on the mathematical principles of geometry and can include Gaussian curvature. However, there are two types of analytical forms which do not fall into the Gaussian subtype: revolution surfaces and rule helicoids. A revolution surface is easiest described as rotating a curve around a straight line. In order to better understand revolution surfaces, think of a potter throwing a pot on the wheel. You have the rotation surface in the middle, and then as the pot goes around, they, you know, form the curvature. And if you were to cut a pie out of there, you would see that straight line that's been revolved around the center. Some examples of revolution surfaces include the Science Center here, but the most popular, I think, you know, kind of the all over the country, is the cooling tower for nuclear power plants. The next type of analytical form is the ruled surface, which is one that can have a straight line through every point of the surface, and a line can be drawn through the surface. While many of the shapes previously discussed will also fall into this category, the one shape that cannot be divided into these other subsections is the ruled helicoid, which can be described as a helix or an unwinding spring. And I know this building isn't made out of concrete, but it is the most pure example of this unwinding, pulling helicoid. A couple other examples include the Guggenheim and the Nautilus House. And the Nautilus House is really interesting because the interior space flows. You go into the living room and then kind of spiral up through the house, up through the different rooms and the levels available. The last group of forms came out of the work of Swiss engineer Heinz Issler, who experimented with how natural forces like gravity, pressure, and flow could be used to our advantage to create more structurally stable, watertight buildings. The experimental nature of Issler's work led to his forms being called experimental forms. These shapes were completely different from other free forms, as these forms do not start with a mathematical principle, nor do they derive from traditional artistic or architectural practices, but from experiments using water, cloth, plastic, resin, and pneumatic forms to create organic structures. The forms produced by these processes follow the laws of nature and are watertight, leak-proof, and can be unprecedentedly thin because they obey the laws of nature. As these shapes were organic in form, they were not easily to calculate and construct. The image on the right shows some of the forms envisioned by Issler that he presented at the 1959 First International Association for Shell Structures and Concrete, which kind of blew the top off of how we thought about thin shell concrete. Issler's experiments led to seemingly endless number of free-form shapes which could be created. The first group of shapes identified were based on the concept of the freely shaped hill, where the molded earth was used to make the form. The next shape was the membrane-shaped hill, where inflated rubber membrane was used to make the shape. then the hanging cloth bowl, and flowing shapes. In order to experiment with pneumatic forms, Isler invented a rectangular pneumatic structure to create pillowed shell using wood frames, a rubber balloon, and a rubber balloon. Roofs designed using the pneumatic systems looked like a large pillow or a group of pillows spanning a large space and were popular for factory roofs. Here's two examples. We've got the single pneumatic form on the left and the group of pneumatic forms on the right. The second and most successful form Isler tested was the hanging form. This form was created by hanging pieces of fabric by its corners, creating tension. The frozen cloth was then overturned to create the compression system, similar to Antoni Gaudí and his funicular models. While buildings constructed implementing the hanging forms were more effective than pneumatic forms, they were also more expensive to construct. These forms proved to be very durable and watertight. Isler was able to remove portions of the roof to create open atrium in the middle of his buildings and still obtain watertight, resilient space with no interior supports. This is two of his most, popular or successful designs. The BP station on the top left, and then the Sicily company in Geneva on the bottom right. And this is the one where he had created the interior. He created his form and then was able to cut out this interior atrium, and there are no interior supports on this. It's one large open space. Another important discovery Isler made at this time was creating the first reusable forming system, which allowed multiple bays of hanging forms to be constructed in rows, leading to long open spaces. These spaces were often utilized for sports complexes, swimming pools, and airplane hangars. And you can see the interior of the space there on the upper right. The last type of experimental forms were the flowing forms. They were created by flowing, pouring, and extrusion. These experiments led to the creation of structures with integral, stable, cantilevered awnings incorporated into the designs. As with his work on hanging forms, structures based on these principles led to airy interior spaces with elongated supports, no interior columns, and they often implemented skylights. So here are just a couple of examples from architects. A lot of these we've already seen and talked about in other ways. So we have some of the famous Saarinen airports here and the preform concrete and thin shell that was used there. Then we have the work of Nervi, which is really funny because this building in the upper right, which involves the intersection of two hyperbolic paraboloids to create that groined vaulted arch. This is a church in San Francisco, which is lovingly called Our Lady of Maytag for its resemblance to the agitator in a washing machine. We already talked about these. Any questions?